outstanding horseman, swordsman and soldier, a virtuoso violinist, a conductor and composer, as well as a regular in the smartest Parisian salons, Joseph Bologne, Chevalier de Saint-Georges, was the very model of 18th century masculinity in all respects, except one. The illegitimate black son of a French plantation owner and an enslaved woman from Guadeloupe, Saint-Georges was the exception in every room he walked into. So how, in an age in which racism was enshrined in law, did this extraordinary man, the earliest black composer whose music has survived in the classical repertoire, go from difficult beginnings to significant professional success and social status? Professor Christopher Dingle helps introduce us to a historical trailblazer whose exceptional story, as well as his music, has been neglected for far too long.
It's an extraordinary story. I truly believe he's one of the most remarkable people ever to have lived. His father always recognised him as his son. There wasn't the kind of wide promiscuity that was typical of plantation owners at the time. He took him with his mother and his official wife and his other daughter to France when Joseph was very young, and brought him up as a young member of the minor nobility. And he learned all the things that a young gentleman needed to know. So he learned etiquette, he learned fencing, dancing, languages and things like that. And he excelled at absolutely everything. And he rose to become part of the King's Guard, hence Chevalier in front of his name. And he became a darling of society, really. Renowned as the best fencer in Europe. There are various famous fencing matches against great masters, but also a crack shot, a great huntsman, a great dancer, an ice skater. He was someone who could swim at a time when that wasn't very common, but not only swim, he could be seen in the mornings swimming across the Seine with one arm behind his back. So he really is rather extraordinary as a figure. And amidst all of that, he was also a brilliant violinist and a leading composer and leading conductor as well, leading the largest orchestras in Paris.
And the French Revolution gave Saint-Georges a chance to use his sword skills in quite a different context, didn't it?
Yes, well, I mean, he'd been using them throughout his life. He'd survived two assassination attempts, one in France, one in London. The second was very definitely in terms of politics and the fact that he was involved with the abolitionist movement and was targeted for that. But then after the revolution, he joined the National Guards, and then became the commander of the 1st Black Regiment in Europe, and distinguished himself with that, and also more or less single-handedly prevented a counter-revolutionary insurgency at Lille as well.
And historically, often I think the first thing people hear about Saint-Georges is this rather pejorative historical term, the Black Mozart. Is that a useful term nowadays?
No, it's an understandable hook, but actually it's looking through the telescope the wrong way. Saint-Georges was the older man. He was the established man when Mozart came to Paris in 1778. So really at the time, people may have thought of Mozart more as being like the white Saint-Georges, apart from the fact that Mozart only did music and didn't have all of these other things that he could do as well. So Saint-Georges was at least as famous as Mozart, if not more so.
And talk to me about his musical output. Are there particular genres he's expert in or enjoys more than others?
So a lot of it, him being a violinist, a lot of it is string-based music. So there are a lot of violin concerti. These are where you get some sense of how good a violinist he was. He was almost certainly an early user of the taut bow, which was around in Paris a lot earlier than people used to think. And the solo parts for those, which were written for himself, as was normal in those days, went very high indeed. So they go an octave or more higher than any of Mozart's violin concerti. Then there's the symphony concertante. So this is this kind of hybrid, to our way of thinking, hybrid form, which is sort of symphonic, but at the same time has soloists. And there's eight surviving of those. There may have been some others. And these are usually for either two violins or violin and viola with strings, maybe a couple of wind. But he also wrote operas as well. Only one of them survives more or less complete, which is L'Amant Anonyme.
And obviously within the history of classical music, he's such a trailblazer, a pioneer. We have no other sort of comparable figure, particularly of a mixed sort of racial heritage in this period in France. Are there other figures in other art forms, in other sort of cultural institutions that are in any way comparable?
It's hard to think of, no matter what their background, someone who is quite as extraordinary as him in so many different fields and in so many different ways. And you know, speaking to someone who's been trying to enthuse people about music for years and encourage interest in various things, and usually you're looking for anecdotes and juicy tidbits to tell about stuff. And with Saint-Georges, there's so much of it that actually gets in the way of the music a bit, and people haven't properly looked at the music itself. It's all been about the story of him and misinformation about him, rather than actually listening to the music. And it's time that we did actually hear some of the music.
A contemporary of Mozart's, Saint-Georges has often been compared to his more famous musical rival. This year, Glyndebourne puts music by both composers side by side in a programme that pairs a performance of Mozart's final work, the vividly dramatic Requiem, with music from Saint-Georges' most popular opera, The Anonymous Lover. But with an actor on the cast list, this won't be a straightforward concert, as director Simone Ibbett-Brown explains. So Simone, you're directing Glyndebourne's new concert of music by the Chevalier de Saint-Georges, but it's not going to look like a conventional concert, is it?
Not quite. So we've got some brilliant musicians and a brilliant actor sharing the stage to celebrate this incredible man and his incredible music. We will be using vocal and instrumental numbers from Saint-Georges' only fully surviving opera, L'Amant Anonyme. It's a tale of love separated by class, written on the eve of the French Revolution. So it was really quite an amazing piece at the time, and I mean, it is now at all times, really. It features classical beauty, but utilised to a really deeply moving effect, and it speaks about human nature and the shape of society with great eloquence and great grace, actually. Mm. It's also got some really unique flavours that I'm hoping will send you to his stunning other music, his violin concerti, his string quartets for more. Mm.
And how does the musical element and the you've got an actor, I believe, how do they interact to sort of to make this theatrical whole?
We're sharing how the opera came to be as a little window into the life of this great man. So we've got an actor portraying the character of Joseph himself, and the singers will be playing both parts in the opera, but also may just have little cameos as other people from his life. So we've got this wonderful sort of multi-faceted glance at just a little window into the life of the Chevalier de Saint-Georges, which honestly is a truly incredible life.
And you've been writing the script in addition to directing this. What have you drawn on? Has he left us some letters, some memoirs, in addition to the biographies?
Really, actually, much of the writing about him is biographical as opposed to autobiographical. There are a few letters that we have, but you really get from the small amount of writings that he's left a flavour of this incredible man full of fire and grace. It comes across a huge amount in his music as well. He was so passionate about making the world better for people, making life, really just ensuring that everyone gets an equal chance to find the beauty and the joy in life. Lots of his work really reflects that, both work on stage, imagining a better world, and then his work off stage, really just fighting for equality, you know, the three great tenets of the French Revolution and of that period.
Simone, I feel like you've had to be, in some ways, a real sort of champion for Chevalier de Saint-Georges and this repertoire. Why is that?
Well, I suppose I always think of it as a more apt question is really, why would I not champion this great music that currently actually so few of us get to enjoy? We feel this sort of, I think everyone feels a sort of prejudice, whether it's personal and more commonly inherited from a shared history, from an education system, and so on. It gives us blinkers, like, you know, like horse blinkers. Do we ever wonder what the rest of the world looks like when we take those blinkers off? I wonder a lot, and, you know, what beautiful scenery might be missing in our history books and in what we teach our children or our students, or, you know, the people around us, our friends and family. You know, we may miss these perfect pockets of inspiration, of genius, that are just waiting to be discovered. So I always wonder, you know, what can I discover? How can I be a champion for something that might inspire the next Chevalier de Saint-Georges?
It feels like a really exciting moment that there's a real audience, there's a real hunger for these new discoveries.
Yeah, exactly. I think, you know, it can feel stressful and difficult, because, but in the end, love and appreciation and interest is not like pie. We're not going to run out. There's enough to go around. So I think, you know, when we take those blinkers off, all we can do is see more beauty in the world. And, you know, I think that's a really great thing.
And the prospect that this might just be the beginning, you know, for every super famous Joseph Bologne, there are 20 more just waiting for us to find in those archives.
Exactly, in those archives and in the classrooms of tomorrow, you know, like, in, you know, a kid may be learning music and think, you know, hear a bit of Joseph Bologne's music and go, wow, I want to be like that. I want to be able to create something like that. And who knows what they'll do.
Two 18th century musical giants come together this autumn on the Glyndebourne tour in an evening of sacred and secular music, a programme in which art and real life are uniquely blended and blurred. Mozart's Requiem and music by Saint-Georges will be performed both on tour in Milton Keynes, Canterbury, Norwich and Liverpool, and here at Glyndebourne. We do hope you can join us.